Okay, so now we are on to topic number 8. So remember, we looked at product costing, which also is for services. We extended that to customers. Now in this one, we are going to look at it into organizational processes. The word process control is mainly for manufacturing, but activity-based management is for processes beyond manufacturing. Okay, so essentially we are going to start looking at monitoring systems. The first application of the ABC was in product costing and profit measurement of products and customers. ABC could also become an important tool in other areas such as process control or activity-based management. First of all, a bit of definitions. Process control is the short-term control of organizational processes within an organization. Operational processes, sorry, within an organization. Its function is to measure processes' outcomes and to take corrective action when the measured outcomes deviate from those desired. Usually, process control refers to the physical manufacturing process. But going beyond manufacturing, you have the same concepts, but we call it activity-based management. That is to manage activities of a whole lot of white-collar departments, such as design engineering, personal administration, purchasing, promotion, process planning, repairs and maintenance, production planning, legal affairs, accounting. All of these are processes. So these sorts of things we're going to look at under activity-based management. Okay. So when you're looking at measuring the performance of a process, you can see we are slowly coming to the last important area in your control framework, which is performance management. So if you do budgeting and we have the actual results, we can do performance management. Now, we have this concept of efficiency or productivity. Efficiency is basically an output-input ratio. Okay, it's called productivity or efficiency. Okay. The output unit divided by the input quantity. Price relationship or recovery is the ratio of output prices to input prices. So together, we have this term called overall effectiveness, the monetary value for all products sold divided by the value of all resources consumed. In other words, the profitability that affects the bottom line. So let's look at that. Okay, so if you have, say, a budget to make 10 units at a cost of $10 a unit, that's the budget, and actual, you made 9 units at a cost of $9 a unit, have you been efficient? Now look at the definitions. Have you been efficient? What do you think? The budget is 10 units at $10 a unit cost. You only made 9 units at a cost of $9 a unit. Have you been efficient? Yes, you have, of course. You have used these resources per unit, which is the output-input ratio. So you have been efficient. But have you been effective? No. So if your profit margin is more than a dollar, then you have not made enough units. So you can see that you have not reached the overall profitability. So you have been efficient but not effective. On the other hand, if you make 11 units at $11 a unit, you have been effective but not efficient. So that's the difference between the two. Okay, so this is what happens. You have overall effectiveness, output quantity, input quantity is efficiency, output prices to input prices is price relationship or recovery. And so we've got to look at both, look at the overall effectiveness. So when you're looking at the manufacturing process these days, you can do these sort of calculations with pinpoint accuracy. Often when you go to a production floor, I mean, I've been to car manufacturing areas like Holden in Australia and so on, you think that the amount of computers there and lasers and all these sorts of robotics and so on, you think you're about to send something to space, okay? Modern machines, tools have gauges which can measure every individual item in the production batch with pinpoint accuracy. Equivalent control techniques exist in other branches of manufacturing. Even after the production stage, the flow of products along a desired channel is very easy to measure due to barcoding, electronic scales, escort memories, laser memories, relational databases. So we know now that we can track an item. If you send the item by courier, you can track exactly where that item is. If you go into a department store with the barcoding, you can know exactly at which checkout register that particular item went through. We have incredible information. In fact, today we can go beyond the checkout register because there is something called nanotechnologies, little electronic particles that is embedded in your clothing, put into your paint when they paint a BMW 7 Series, where even if you take all the paint out, if you steal the car, there may be some paint embedded behind the door that can pinpoint where the car is. Okay, so these days, they can tell exactly not only where you bought an item of clothing, but when you wore it and where you are. Okay, and these are incredible things. I mean, they are, the amount of tracking that they can do to people is like now incredible, and we don't even know it. There's no real privacy. As you well know, your phone is able to, someone is able to tell you exactly where you are with your phone. Not only that, you know, if you are about to have an affair with your girlfriend, okay, make sure not only that you put your phone off, you take the battery out, okay, because even if the phone is off, they can tell you where you are. And in England, one particular person was prosecuted because he was stealing something while his phone was on, and they knew exactly where he was, and he was in the house that he shouldn't have been in. Okay, so put your phone off. Okay, but these days, it may not only be the phone, it may be your clothing, it may be where you drive, you never know how they're tracking you. Okay, so it's incredible. So they haven't got as far as, you know, putting a chip inside the body, but it is happening in Brazil. There's so much of kidnappings of the legal department that every person in the legal department has a barcode embedded, like Schwarzenegger had in one of those movies. Okay, they've got actually a barcode embedded in the Brazilian justice system. So that's where it is going. Okay, so they are even putting nanotechnologies into orange juice. I don't know why that people are drinking it to see what's inside, happening inside. I don't know if it's going to cause cancer or not. Okay, the medical science hasn't gone as far as the electronic information that is being collected. Okay, so interesting. And yesterday I saw that Google has now set up a service because very many people, you know, would have their Google accounts and their Gmails and so on. Well, after they die, it is almost like, you know, your karma is being recorded by Google. Okay, even after you die, it is in the atmosphere. So now they have just put a service out that the family can record and access your parents' emails. Okay, it's called lovemom.com or something that Google is providing the service, that you can keep the memory of your mother alive by accessing his or her, your father or mother's electronic databases even after they have passed away. Well, I know one thing, I don't want my son or my wife to get my emails after I go. Okay, I must make sure that they never get access to that one. Okay, that would be quite dangerous. Okay, sorry? Okay, so in terms of monitoring indirect departments, activity-based management, of course, white-collar departments have not received nearly as much attention as production workers, although in modern industrial settings, they account for an increasing proportion of overhead costs. Okay, so we haven't been yet subjected to laser memories and so on and so forth, and barcoding. The reason is that monitoring of indirect departments which embrace amongst others knowledge workers like ourselves is difficult. Now they can do some of it, okay, by using either time card, which is very obsolete. I mean, very many people don't clock in and clock out. But the security passes, well, that's another thing. They're supposedly you have a security badge to tell, you know, that you're an employee, but every time you swipe it to get in, swipe it to go out, of course they can keep track of your movements. So these sorts of, and then your login of your computer, of course these days, are being kept track of. So you can find out if a person has come to work and has logged on to the computer. But still, it's some way before we can measure output. They can come to work and go to sleep. Okay, come to work, log on to the computer and go to sleep. Okay, or do something else. So output is the problem. Now this causes a headache for the finance manager. Now this is not in your notes, but basically the finance manager looking at budget versus actual and has this problem because the costs are too high. So how do you cut costs? Now many of you are finance managers who are in these departments and you've come across this problem. You've been asked to cut costs by the top guys. How do you do it? Well, the problem is it's difficult to find solutions. So what you do is normally, you do something like this, downsize. That's the easiest one. Get rid of a few staff, okay? Downsize. Now I know that many consulting firms, they come to your organization and say, we will cut costs by 20%. They are not thinking of anything else in their head except we will get rid of a few staff. That's the easiest way to cut costs. So of course, when those consultants leave and a few people have been made redundant, of course the next consultant who comes has a very hard time. Okay, so downsizing. Well, there's sometimes across the board sort of knee-jerk reaction, let's reduce every cost by 10%. Okay, that's another one. Stop all recruitment. So if you can't get rid of people, then at least don't hire any new people. Halt all capital projects. Don't buy computers for 3 years. Let them be all outdated. Never mind, we will stop making, okay, we will stop spending money. Well, if all that doesn't work, switch off the lights, please, before you go home. Okay? Lock the stationery cupboard so to prevent people from taking stationery home for their children to do their homework. And maybe no phone calls until 1 p.m. so that you can do a bit of work before the phone starts ringing. Okay, so these are called knee-jerk reactions. Knee-jerk reactions because you really don't know where to cut costs. You start with the big ones and go down to the small ones. Huge focus on CapEx, all capital projects. Okay. So this is things, the reason for this sort of reaction is because they can't pinpoint where the problem is. So what we are going to show is that, in fact, the reason why we have this knee-jerk reaction is because many of us, doesn't matter if you're using SAP or Oracle or whatever, we get our departmental report in this format. How much is spent on salaries, are the benefits, travel, car, occupancy, telephone, etc. Am I correct? Please tell me, is your department getting information about the your department's performance with a report like this? Most likely correct, right? So, okay. So where do you cut costs? The big one is salaries, downsize. And then go across the board 10% and so on. Okay, so that is the way we get our reports, and that is why we have these sorts of reactions. But what if we give the same report like this? What did we do with the money? Follow leads. Customer support, processing orders, checking prices, chasing factory. Okay, still the same as 6500, but now these are activities. How did we get this? Because we did those interviews and so on. So things like chasing the factory for late orders, checking prices. You can see that these things, and meetings of course, is non-value added. Remember that person who went to the restaurant? These are not things that you can get the customer to pay extra for. So that's where you can reduce costs. So ABC provides a new approach to implementing change in white-collar departments. The key information is to use cost drivers as an approximation of the output of the various departments. So the number of routings, the number of drawings, the number of purchase orders, your cost drivers can be used as approximations of output. Remember I said output is the problem, input is not, but output is. Why don't we look at these as approximations of output? This is quite natural since cost drivers explain why a certain activity consumes a certain amount of resources. However, these do not include information about the quality of the output or the difficulties inherent in the task. So you don't say, okay, if you're doing a technical drawing, some drawing might be easy, some might be very complicated. At the moment, we are not going to look at the differences with that, or if it's a number of bank reconciliations, some may be easy, some may be difficult. Okay, we simply count the output as the initial step. That is ABC. So what we're saying is this, that our information that we collected using for ABC, which is a cost allocation view, we looked at the resources, we looked at the activity that the resources do, we found the link of the cost drivers, and we applied it to the cost objects. So these four, which is in the here, cost object, resources, activities, cost driver, those four, we take those same cost drivers and activities as performance measures of output. That is the process view. Okay, so that's what we are doing. So here is a case that I did at Telstra, the South Australian division of Telstra. This is a purchasing department. You can see processing requisitions and in more detail and the time spent, expediting orders, processing receipts. So the FU is the follow-up, okay? And the time and the cost per cost driver. Okay, so things such as amending, follow-up, back orders, cancelling. These things are non-value-adding activities. So if you can get this right in the first place, you can reduce costs. So in fact, we found that 13% of the time clarifying details, 11% of the time generating amended orders, 29% of the time expediting orders, in other words, 53% of the time wasted. And that is an area where you can do significant cost reductions. 23% of the time spent on administration. In terms of value add, just 10%. Okay, so tremendous scope for cost reductions rather than those knee-jerk reactions. But you have to be careful. You have to be careful that when you say that you are clarifying and amending, sometimes you have to do it. It's simply that we have said the customer is not going to pay you extra. But if you don't do it, you might reduce the quality of the product. So this is not in your notes, but just a humorous way of looking at non-value-adding activities. This is a management consultant's report on Schubert's Unfinished Symphony. Now, Schubert was a classical composer, and he had a symphony that he died before he could finish doing that symphony. So management consultant was asked to do a report on it. So this is what he said. All 12 violins played the same notes. This is needless duplication. Their number should be cut. For a considerable period of time, the oboe player had nothing to do. Their number should be reduced, and their work spread amongst other staff. No useful purpose is served by repeating with horns, that is the chords, passages already handled by the strings. Okay? Eliminating such redundancies would enable the concert to be cut by 20 minutes. The symphony has two movements. Mr. Schubert should have been able to achieve his musical goals in one. Conclusion, if Mr. Schubert had paid attention to these matters, he would have had time to finish the symphony before he died. Okay. Right? Now, of course, we don't know what it would have sounded like. Okay. So, when I showed this to Telecom Malaysia senior management, the head of IT got very excited. He was not on account. He said, Professor Pop, you got to give me this handout. I said, why? I want to show the accountants this. Okay? So I said, tell me the story. He said that he was interested in this oboe player. Because in Telecom Malaysia IT, they have people all over Malaysia who are going to handle problems if the network goes down. If the network collapses, or if for some reason, then they go and repair it. But most of the time, the network is okay. So these guys are playing cards and smoking and waiting for the network to go down, maybe once a month or once every 2 months, right? But they are over there. So the accountant said, this is, you know, they have nothing to do, so why don't we have a few of these people in KL, and when there is a problem, we fly them to the location to set up the network, troubleshoot the network. What happened? Of course, the network goes down in a certain area. By the time you get a flight, go to the airport and go to that other place to set the whole thing up, the company has lost millions of dollars of revenue of calls that are not completed. So even though these people are not doing anything, had nothing to do, when they had to do something, they could do it fast and save the company a amount of money. So that's the sort of thing that you could get if you try to do too much of this value adding and non-value adding. Okay, so make sure the overriding, the quality must be maintained. Okay, otherwise you'll have this management consultants, Schubert's symphony. Okay, so let's go back to value adding. Back to the telco service unit, in terms of line activation, that is activating a line for the new phone call, they said that earlier, traditionally, they used to give their reports like this, but today, they're doing it based on ABM principles. How much of activities went on line activations, network maintenance, product design, service changes, customer queries. So here is a better way of looking at what areas you could reduce costs. In terms of activation, determine that 35% of activations are reserved within 7 days. Now that's interesting. They gave a customer a line, activated a line, and there was a problem with that activation, they had to come and reservice. It's 35% of the time. And that's an area where significant changes could be done. 45% of the time was idle time. Activation cost between regions fluctuated by up to 35%. Best international activations cost was within 5% of best in class. So they were having both best and worst within that same organization in terms of line activation. Okay, again, information that comes by doing an activity-based costing exercise. Okay, so now if you can do your actual results using, you can do your actual results and output based on activities. Can you use it to do budgeting? Traditional budgeting implies level by level allocation of overhead costs from supporting cost centers to production cost centers using a volume related allocation base. Common backpack cut by production cost centers are often a source of discontent. So that happens over here. What happens is, especially people in selling and admin, they start doing lots and lots of things to, because they don't really care much about their costs, because the costs are driven down to the product level. So these guys do various things, and the poor guys down here have to carry the load of those costings, because these guys are not evaluated on their output and the costs. So these are called common backpacks. Activity-based budgeting is an extension of activity-based management, undertake to improve the planning and effectiveness of white-collar departments, not allow them to ad hoc do various projects without thinking of the consequences. So here's an example of a sales order department. So you can see the cost driver, the cost pools driven by the number of customer, cost driver, number of orders, export orders, dispatches. Now those four have cost driver information. So you can get cost per cost driver. These are, by the way, thousands of dollars. But there may be some things that they do that there is no cost driver. Now this is called sustaining costs. Sustaining costs. So if you look at the flow chart over here, any cost that is you can't, that is not direct, and you can't find a cost driver that goes to a higher level, that is called a sustaining cost. Okay? It's not a cost that we can allocate to this level, but it's important. So these would go to a higher level, a sustaining cost. So sales, list and sales literature, price list and sales literature sustaining cost, and department sustaining cost, there's no cost per cost driver, no output measure. Okay, so this is a typical budget that you can do if you have done an ABC exercise and got the number of cost drivers. Okay, so now if you have got the budget and got the actual results, you can do activity-based cost variance analysis, the feedback. Okay, this feedback process. Okay, consider for example a white-collar department like purchasing and how it relates to one product via a cost driver. Assume that the values of the following variables are known: the budgeted and actual cost of the activity, which is the cost of running the purchasing department, the budgeted actual number of cost drivers, and the budgeted actual sales volume. So this is given in the chart over here. Now, I know that it's getting a little late in the day, but I want you all to concentrate on this because it's a little bit difficult area and needs a little bit of concentration. Okay, various analysis is always a difficult area. Okay, so once again, as I told you, the activity is the purchasing department. They are expected to write purchase orders, which is 1,000 purchase orders, and the product for which they're buying the components is refrigerators, where they're going to make 1,000 refrigerators. Okay? 10,000, thank you. Actually, they spent only 28,000. They wrote only 880 purchase orders, but they made 11,000 units. Okay, so that's the information. Now let's analyze this. If there was traditional costing, they would not have this middle section. So they would take the budget, divide by the number of products, and it is how much? 30,000, so $3. And actual, 28,000 divided by 11, I think $2.55. Okay, so it will look like this department is very favorable, right? They have reduced costs. Okay, so $2.55 versus $3, favorable. But on the ABC, we are saying, no, the output is measured by the number of cost drivers. So these guys are supposed to write 1,000 cost drivers, which is $30 a cost driver. They wrote only 880 cost drivers. Yes, they spent a little bit less money, but they wrote less cost drivers. So it is 3182. Cost per cost driver has gone up. Okay? So now I want you all to think about it. What do you think? Do you think that this purchasing department has done well or badly? Should we give a reward to the purchasing manager or should we punish the purchasing manager?
Efficient but not effective.
Well, effective in terms of the refrigerators, the production guy has been very efficient, very effective, 1,000.
Maybe
extra, 1,000 extra. Okay, so my question again is, should we give a bonus to this guy or should we punish him? Should we give a bonus because traditional says favorable, or should we punish him because it appears that he's actually spent more money writing purchase orders? Okay, now, before we go any further, let us say, my friend at the back from Egypt, isn't it? Okay, let us say that you are the purchasing manager, right? And I have come to you and said, hey, look, you have not written enough purchase orders and it is unfavorable. I'm going to punish you with a reduction of your bonus or whatever. You have a wife, children, children's education, maybe mistress, I don't know, okay? You don't want to lose your job, so what are you going to do the next time I come? How are you going to react to my telling you that you have not performed well? Someone, others can help you. How would you react?
I will increase the number of purchase order regardless of the.
Very good. How are you going to do that? How can you increase the number of purchase orders?
Split.
You can't split
yes.
the purchase order. Absolutely right. That's exactly what you're going to do.
Yes.
Okay, so earlier you had a purchase order, okay, to your supplier, company X. Please give us this component, this component, this components. Now you split it in two purchase orders to company X, and now suddenly you have got double the amount of purchase orders, and therefore cost per purchase order reduces to half the cost, and you have done extremely well. Okay, well done. You get a double bonus. Now does that make sense? Doesn't make sense, isn't it? So is there any value in this computation? Actually there is, but not to the purchasing manager. The value of this computation is, the responsibility for this is not the purchasing manager, but the product manager, the refrigerator manager, who called upon the purchasing department. As one can see, the budgeted number of cost drive events was too high. We expected 1,000 purchase orders to be written, only 880 were written for even more products. The estimation of the budget number of cost drivers that will be required is the responsibility of the product manager, the refrigerator line manager, who based his estimation on the number of parts that will be required to manufacture refrigerators. Okay? The product manager's control over the number of cost drivers or purchasing orders required, and can reduce this number, for example, by reducing the number of parts used if this is feasible. So it is the product manager who has influence, not the purchasing manager. Therefore, based on the predicted workload, if too many purchasing people are hired, this is not the fault of the purchasing manager, but the manager who forecasts the demands that are going to be made of the purchasing department, which is the product manager. Okay, now let me give you another example to make you all understand this. Yes?
Maybe the cost driver we selected wasn't effective.
No, but the cost driver for the purchasing department has to be purchase orders. Yeah, that's the most effective cost driver
because
for that.
Because we found that there is a drawback here, because maybe he issued to order with very high value, and this 100 order with the same value.
Yeah, so purchasing, it's not the fault of the purchasing manager. The product manager thought that they'll need 1,000 purchase orders. In fact, the purchasing manager seemed to have done it more efficiently. So let me give you another example and come back to you. In my university, there is a printing department that prints all these books that you're having, right? So what do? Before the term starts, they phone all the lecturers. So they phone me and say, Prof, are you going to, how many students do you have for your course next semester? Now I can actually go and check it out, but because I know some international students who come late and all that, okay, I just tell them, maybe same as last year plus about 10% more. So they record it. Then they tell me, Prof, are you going to have the same size book that you printed last year? I say, maybe, and I'm thinking, maybe I can put some new articles and so on. So I say, no, maybe about 5% bigger. So they do their calculations, 10% more students, 5% bigger, and they order all the paper. They hire a staff member to do all the photocopying for this big load. Now what happens actually? The number of students have reduced by 10%, and I had decided to take some articles out, and my book is smaller. Okay, so suddenly, the printing department has too much of paper on their hands, and they've hired a person that they haven't used. So whose fault was that? My fault, isn't it? I am the product manager. Okay, I gave the wrong information to the to the printing department. Okay, but luckily in my university, they're not going to come after me. Okay, if they do, I'll be more careful, right? But that is the problem here. It is the product manager who forecast the demand that was wrong. The head of service or purchasing cost center has to only control and record the level of activity and observe the number of cost drivers and record idle time, overcapacity in the department. Otherwise, he or she might be blamed for having a productivity decrease when actually productivity has in fact increased. In this case, the traditional actually gave a better idea of the information. The ABC was useful to pinpoint it to the product manager. So actually both were helpful here. Okay, I hope that you've understood it. It's not an easy area because we are going to point the finger at the wrong person if you don't understand these things properly. Okay. Now this is one of the big problems I have with time-driven ABC. Because time-driven ABC of Kaplan asked the managers, so how many, you know, we are talking about the top administration manager, how many purchase orders do you think the purchasing department should be writing? So they say about 1,000. The purchasing department now say, I will split my orders. So suddenly they look very, very good. So the whole thing gets completely haywire when you try to do that sort of overall analysis with this method of time-driven ABC. Okay, so I don't agree with that. Data. I mean, Kaplan is a really fantastic guy. You saw him on video. He's the one who wrote a book called Advanced Management Accounting, which told how to do traditional. Then he completely changed his mind and came up with ABC. Now he's changed his mind again and come up with TDABC. Every time he does that, he gets massive consultancies and sells a lot of books and has a lot of software that he sells. Okay, so however, I think ABC is technically stronger than TDABC, clearly. Okay? And it's not that difficult to sustain if you do it properly. Okay, now here's another example, cost follow-up. This is now a lot of reading to be done, but it's worth reading this. A customer orders a product consisting of 400 components. Most of the components are standard parts, but 20 require new drawings because of minor changes. Two other components have never been manufactured and cannot be purchased, leaving the R&D department to design and develop them. The factory estimates that the number of manufacturing orders at 120, machine hours at 300, and direct labor hours at 200. The material value is forecast at 20,000. It is necessary to order 50 different components from subcontractors. Finally, the warehouse department estimates that the number of issues or parts taken from inventory at 250. The number of cost driver events is estimated as shown in the figure. Okay, so you can see that these are the numbers we've talked about. Just one customer order, 50 products, 200 issues of materials, 20 new drawings, etc. And here is the cost per cost driver. So the total, there are two direct amounts, direct materials and direct labor for 200 hours. Okay. So that's the estimation. For a particular, so this is very good for project management. Those companies here who do project management, this sort of analysis is very useful. Okay, now you're told that the actual cost information was as follows. Material was 19,500. The budget was 20,000. Labor was 17,100. The budget was 18,000. The labor you did with 190 hours, the budget was 200 hours. So traditionally, everything is favorable. Okay, materials favorable, labor favorable, and because the labor was favorable, automatically the overhead allocation also becomes favorable, and there will be underpaid overhead later. But the project has a favorable variance, so everyone is happy. Okay, now let's look at the actuals. In this case, you're told that actually they had 45 products, overhead for 45 products, that there were 260 issues, yes, 190 direct labor hours only, 310 machine hours, 135 production planning versus 120, 28 new drawings, etc. Okay, these are the two direct. Now you can see that there are some plus and some minus. Okay, and overall, it's a minus 6,900. Okay, so what you thought was a successful project management actually was not profitable. Not only that, two areas gives you very good information that you plan for too little in terms of production planning and too few new drawings. Those are the big ones that have made the project unfavorable. Okay, so that's periodical activity-based budgeting combined with real-time activity cost follow-up offers an excellent instrument to measure the monetary consequences of making a multitude of small decisions, even in white-collar support departments. Any questions up to now? Right, now let's look at some wider issues. First of all, what should we be measuring? The key performance variable, what should we be measuring? Now I'm going to use an example given by Kaplan in his book, Relevance Lost, The Rise and Fall of Management Accounting. Okay, in that book he says, you know, he takes us back about 500 years into, that's my drawing of Italy, Arabia, India, we better put Sri Lanka there, and somewhere there is the court of Kublai Khan, 500 years ago, between Venice and the court of Kublai Khan was the Silk Route, opened up by Marco Polo. Okay, so Marco Polo opened this up and there was lots of things happening in the Silk Route, not only silk, but also spices, and all were going transported with camels, okay, in this Silk Route, transported through Arabia and Asia and all that. So it is actually not by accident that you have noodles in China and pasta in Italy. It is because of the Silk Route, okay, same sort of food. In fact, well, some person had done a PhD, but those who are interested in PhD is an excellent topic. He started here and he showed how noodles changed to pasta along the way. And he showed a lot of fusion food also in the middle. I would love to do a PhD like that. Okay, so not only products, but also values, family values are very similar along the Silk Route. Medicines, all of this is because of the Silk Route, and not only that, accounting. Because 500 years ago, Luca Pacioli, a mathematician in Venice, wrote a book called Principia Mathematica, and one of the chapters was on double entry accounting. And he didn't say he invented it, he said the traders are using it, right? And so people think that because Pacioli wrote Principia Mathematica in Venice, that was the where accounting started, but actually, most likely, it started in India. Because India has been credited by inventing the concept of zero. So zero means plus and minus, debit and credit. So some academicians think that it was the Indian traders who came up with this double entry accounting concept that was written up by Pacioli. Anyway, let us now say that you are on top of a camel on the Silk Route, taking spices and silks, and you are in the middle of the Rajasthan desert. Okay? You're on top of a camel. Now, what is the key performance variables or critical success factors that you have to measure to make sure that you do your job properly? What do you think? You're on top of a camel, Rajasthan desert, sun is very hot, burning on you. Very good, okay. So health of camel. Weight of camel or yourself? Well, the weight of goods, I suppose, unless there is some perishables there, would not change that much, the silks. Okay, but the condition of the stock might change, such as the silks might perish, sand might get into the spices. So I put that at the bottom, condition of stock. That has to be checked occasionally. Okay, what is key? Sorry? What do you mean by facilities? Okay. Let's say distance, okay. Distance. I thought something else.
You can say distance and direction.
Distance. Direction, time. Okay, yes. Anything else?
Danger.
The ends are very good. What do you measure? Bandit activity? Weapon supply? Weapon supply. Okay. Anything else? Sorry? Of the camel or yourself. Well, someone said entertainment. Okay? That's why when you said road conditions, I was wondering what you meant by that. Okay, let's not put that one down. Okay? So health of care, one very important thing that you missed out. Yes, food and water. Yeah, they can. True, but you can't. Okay? So food, water, okay, condition of stock. Another one would be weather forecast. Are you going to have snow, sandstorms, okay, and so on. I don't know if you all watched Mission Impossible Ghost Protocol, where they showed Dubai, and they showed that sandstorm coming. Yes. Have you ever seen a sandstorm like that, like in a movie?
No.
I had never seen one. Okay.
Even in Dubai.
That is supposed to be Dubai. Okay. Anyway, so you can see that what now the people who are interested in profit will be the traders here and in China. They'll be interested in the fifth quarter profit of 1495, let us say, or fourth quarter profit. There's no fifth quarter. Right? But you will not be interested in that when you're on top of a camel. This is called the technician level. But if any one of these things go wrong, if the camel turns unhealthy, if you go the wrong way, if bandits attack you, if you run out of food, the weather turns bad, if your stock spoils, no profit, right? So you can see that it is these things that drive profit, not the other way around. Getting these things right results in profit. Having a problem here is a loss. So that is what Kaplan is trying to say. What is the key performance variable that should be measured? Often, we take a top-down approach by starting with profit, but really it should be a bottom-up approach. Okay. Next one, how frequent must the reports be? Problems with monthly reporting, which is the top-down approach. Sometimes you can't wait a month. I mean, bandit activity every 2 hours. Weather forecast every 3-4 hours. You can see some of these have to be done even less than a day. Okay, so again, a problem with waiting till the end of the month. What about timeliness versus accuracy? Now there's more information in your notes. Okay, you can see it's a trade-off. I already talked about quick and dirty, but fast. Okay, with fast closing and so on. There is a trade-off between timeliness and accuracy. Okay, so you'll be looking at that trade-off. Faster you get it, the better it is, but there will be lots of accuracy. But we don't need auditor level accuracy for monthly reports, or even reports on a daily basis. And finally, what level of detail is required? These are called executive information systems. Okay, where at the top level, now I'll be giving you showing you examples of this later on. At the top level, you have very summarized information, very narrow arrows. But as you go down, you get more and more detailed information until you get extremely detailed information at the operation or machine. So that's the detailed information that you have here, the health of the camel and so on. Now the person up here doesn't want to know about every hourly report of the health of the camel. But you need summarized information. So going downwards is called drill down with more and more detail, and more summarization is called drill up. So this is called executive information systems. Okay, now one of my person that does the CMA program in-house is a company called Coles Myer Australia, very large department store. They tell that they can get profitability per cash register. So if you have 20 cash registers in a supermarket, they can tell you that register number 14 is more profitable than register number 20. Not only that, that women with children, small children, prefer registers number 4 and 5, then men appear to prefer register number 7 or 8, and so on and so forth. Now I asked them, why do you need all that information? They said, very, very important. Okay, if it's a register that is more frequented by women, we put women's, you know, children's, you know, confectionaries and sweets, okay, so that the child can reach out and get them, and the mother doesn't want to say no because the mother behind my teeth is a bad mother, okay? And you put the batteries and the shavy stuff where the men come, and that sort of thing. They want to know profitability per cash register. That's the amount to drill down that they do. Okay, so these are all issues that will come about when you're looking at these information systems.